Now, welcome, friends, to this afternoon session of our monthly meeting. I'm very happy that you are all here, and I can share some of my experiences on the spiritual path based upon the teachings I received from my master, great master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh Ji. It's his teaching that has given me these experiences, and I think those teachings are good universally for everybody. The way we talk about our spiritual journey is like we have to go somewhere. That's the meaning of a journey. Journey means you travel somewhere. Now, unfortunately, we call this a spiritual journey, but we don't go anywhere. In fact, we don't travel at all. If we travel, we don't reach our destination. Our mind is running. The more it runs, the further it gets away from the destination. If it stops running, we would go there. So it's the exact opposite of what we think about a journey. So it's not a journey. The destination which we have to reach, which we call our true home, Sachkhand, true home, is already there with us. We don't have to go anywhere. It's already there. The different levels of experiences I was explaining to you are already there. None of them has to be created or reached by any means. They're there already in all of us, completely. So there is nothing for us to go anywhere to reach. There's no journey involved at all. What we are doing is to remove the coverings, the veils upon ourselves. The veils are covering our own destination within ourselves. When we remove one veil after another, we discover what is inside. Ultimately, we remove all the covers, we discover who we are, and we discover where we belong. So this is not a journey, it's an uncovering of the veils of illusion that we have put around us, which create the world which look real. The process of illusion has been used very successfully by consciousness to create realities instead of creating illusions. The process is illusion, the result is reality. All these are different levels of realities being created, because there is no way we can ever dismiss any one of these experiences as unreal. People come to me, I have discovered this is unreal. I take a little pin and poke on them and they cry. How can you be crying like this if it's unreal? A man once came to our Dera, great master's time, and I remember, and he was so self-opinionated, he had reached Sachkhand, he had reached all those levels, and he was sitting outside on a platform giving discourses to people. Oh, I have done all these things. And I know that if you have crossed your mind, that level, you can never get angry no matter what the provocation. There are some signs that you cannot be egoistic, you cannot be promoting your I-ness if you have crossed that level. You cannot have lustful feelings if you have crossed that level. There are some signs which only exist when we are within the realm of the mind. Somebody has crossed that, will not have any of these things. Even an obvious way, you won't be able to see it. And that man was giving a lot of talks. I was a young boy at that time. I'm maybe only 10 years old or something, 9 or 10 years old. And I was standing, seeing all the people being attracted and listening to this enlightened man. I had a safety pin with me. I opened up the safety pin and went on the side, poked it in. He howled, he got up, he was so angry. He ran after me, but I could run faster than him. I only told him, I said, where are the five boys? Because we used to refer to these five vices as five boys. Five boys who leave you when you cross the mind and go into your spiritual self, they don't remain with you. They're only part of the mind. So I just shouted to him, where are the five boys? He was so angry. So you see, when we talk so much, very learned people are there. They talk of a spiritual journey. There is no journey. It's a sort of awakening. You wake up like from a dream. If you're having a dream, then you say, I want to journey into a wakefulness. There's no journey. When you wake up, the dream ends. It's like that. The levels of reality, levels of creation are like that. The only confusing part is in the beginning. It's more confusing that when you go to the next level of awareness, there's an overlap, an experience of overlap with the physical and the astral. That means you can be disembodied, have no body, and still can see this world as created now. Though you know that part of you is aware of something higher, and part of you is still working in this body. That overlap creates a confusion in many people because they don't go beyond that in their meditation. In their meditation, they withdraw, they're in that level, they don't go within that body. And when they're only in the astral body, they can be in the overlap with the disembodied spirits. There are lots of them. I won't talk of today, but many of my lectures are attended by them. And you can't see them because they're disembodied, but they're still connected with this world. And they still roam around here. That's what they call ghosts. They call bhoot, preet. They're all part of this overlap. They are not visible because they're not having a physical body, but they're still connected with the world. So this causes some confusion. Now the way I'm saying this morning and now, everything is already there. You can just put your attention, looks very easy. Looks simple. It is simple, but not easy. Now why is it not easy? If it is so simple, why is it not easy to do something that should be so simple as to go within yourselves? Nobody is required to do this thing. You have to just go inside. At least the initial steps are so easy, anybody can do it. You don't need a master also. You don't need a teacher even. You can self-practice and see what happens if you go and withdraw your attention inside and see what happens. Then why is it difficult? The difficulty comes because the very attention we want to put inside us is scattered outside. It's scattered in so many ways. And the reason for scattering of attention is that the role we were supposed to play was merely to enjoy what was around us. But we fell in love with it, we got attached to it. The more attached we got to it, the more our desires increased for that or similar experiences. These desires and attachments, these two things, have scattered our attention completely all over. Every time we want to sit in the mind, in our own head, with our eyes closed, the mind runs to all these places to which it is attached. If you try to do very serious meditation, I am going to do like a hatha yogi, stubborn yogi. Now, stubbornness, I want to just get it done, no matter what. And you try hard, the mind runs more. We have made the mind, which was a machine to help us, into an entity of its own. It's not a living thing. We made it living by giving it our own consciousness. We put life into the mind and made it a living thing. We put life into the sensory perception, made it living. We put life into this body, made it living. It's our own delegation of life, of consciousness, to these covers upon ourselves, which make them alive. The mind is alive because of us. If you pull the attention out of the mind, we go away. Of course, we don't know how to pull because pulling is like mental action. That is why it looks like it should be a simple process of going within. Our attachments and our desires have made it difficult. Now, what can we do? If we are so attached to things, every time we want to meditate, our mind thinks of outside things. It's a universal experience. I have had the experience, my friends have had the experience, I don't know anybody who doesn't have the experience, that when they try to meditate upon themselves, the mind doesn't think of themselves, the mind thinks of outside things. Common thing, because we are attached. Then they tell us, you should practice detachment. Why do they say that? Because attachment is causing all the problem and making it difficult. A simple thing is being made difficult because of attachment. Therefore, the solution suggested is detach yourself from these things. I want to tell you my experience. Nobody can detach himself from any attachment. You can try as hard as you like. The harder you try to detach, the more attached you will get. Actual experience. I came to this country. I loved pizza. In those days, ye old Shakey's pizza. And I said, I am getting attached. I came to this country to do something else, and this pizza has come in my way. So I have to get detached from it. So I closed my eyes and no more pizza, no more shaking pizza. The more I said, the more pizza came in front of me. The more I tried to detach, the more it got attached. I found detachment doesn't work. And I then found out from my friends that it never worked with anybody. That trying to push something away from your mind never works, because you are getting your mind more involved in it. How can you be detached? Attachment comes by putting your mind on something, and then you're putting your mind more on the same thing to get detached. How will it happen? So detachment can never be done by detachment. It can be done by another way. And that is, attach yourself to something else. I attached myself to another, fortunately or unfortunately, another pizza from Pizza Hut. But anyway, Pizza Hut created another problem for me, but detached me from Shakey's pizza. I discovered the secret. The secret of detachment is to be attached to something else. Therefore, the secret of being detached from everything outside is to be attached to something inside. Great clue came to me. That if you really want to detach, not one thing at a time, you can't do one thing at a time. But if you want to have a wholesale detachment, with all your attachments outside, which are all outside, attach yourself to one thing inside, so powerful that it should hold your attention and make you detached from outside things. I try to find out what are the kind of things I can be attached to inside. I said, inner pizza. It didn't work at all. I made my own pizza store inside. It would still pick up all the ideas from outside. I found out that anything I make with my mind is from outside. So my mind could make up nothing to detach me from outside. I said, I have to find something that is not outside. Or it should be so outside, such a way that it is in a real form, in a more attractive form, it should be inside. It took me a little while, but I found the answer. That the love I was experiencing, unconditional love, of a unique quality, with no judgment in it, no conditions in it, no expectations in it, a love that I had not seen, but I saw from my master, that love was not only outside in his own form, inside when I looked at him inside. And that love can pull you to an extent you can be detached from everything. It's not a worldly thing. It's already inside. So the secret was to find something inside. I had difficulty in answering some questions that if we are finding our own self, why do we need a master? If we are trying to find God and God is inside us, why do we need a third party and intermediary outside? Why do we want an agent outside to tell us that God is inside you? I was saying this is a good question. That if everything is inside us and we have to find it by our own self, what's a third party role in that? There should be some significant role apart from the role that I mentioned in the morning, that the outside person who is a perfect living master, not any teacher. Teachers can take you up to a certain level. We are talking of going beyond the mind. A perfect living master is actually your own master inside you. It's your own self manifesting as a perfect living master. And therefore, you are not being guided from outside, you are being guided from inside. You close your eyes, you don't see the inside. He comes outside to show you, he takes you inside. If a person says, he's a perfect living master and he's going to draw you outside, either to himself or to temples or to other objects of worship. He's taking you outside. But if he comes and says, go inside, you want to find me inside, you want to find the truth, go inside. Then that's one characteristic of a perfect living master. But why would he say that? If he has to say, tell us, I am a perfect living master and I've come to tell you that, he's not a perfect living master. Why would he be so trying to convince us from outside something if the job is to be done inside? But if he appears as an ordinary person and remains an ordinary person throughout our experience, but his consciousness is pulling us from inside, his love is pulling us from inside, And he never says he's a perfect living master. But he keeps on pulling us from inside. And as we deal with him, we discover how unconditional his love is. How he loves us, whether we love him or not. If we love him, he loves us. If we hate him, he loves us. If we hurt him, he loves us. If we kill him, he loves us. And never expects, he never says, be a good boy, good girl, then I will love you. He loves you irrespective. He passes no judgment whatsoever. It's a very unusual experience. But when that experience gets repeated again and again, then we realize it's not what he's telling us to do. It's the love that's pulling us. Sometimes he can tell almost nothing, tell stories. We are still pulled by him. So it is the love that is coming from beyond the mind that pulls us and detaches us from things outside. You can't practice detachment, but you can practice attachment to something that is inside you, but being expressed for the moment outside in the form of a human being who has this kind of awareness. Awareness shown to us by means of his unconditional love and other forms which we may not see immediately, but later on we can see. First thing to realize is, if such a person is actually a manifestation of our own higher self, just happened to appear like an ordinary human being, if we go and put our attention inside, will he be there? If he's not even there, then he's only outside. But if he's there in our own meditation, in our own introspection, in going within ourselves, then he is our inside, which is coming outside. So that is why what we get at all times is from the master inside. Till we reach that point, we get it from the figurehead, the expression outside in the form of a human being. Human being is like other human beings. He's born, dies, has a temporary life here, lives like us. So therefore, there's nothing extraordinary in the human being. The extraordinary thing is in the consciousness which he translates by being at that level beyond the mind from where he pulls us inside, beyond the mind. It's important to remember that this is something that expresses the role. What is the role of a human being who is a perfect living master? The role is, first of all, to be a symbol of our own self outside. Secondly, to express while we are here in the physical world that unconditional love which cannot come while you are working with the mind and must come. And then to pull you inside to his real self which is also inside you, and thereby show you at the end that there was no difference between you and yourself. The self was the same. It's just an expression of your own self. Your own true self is being expressed in the physical world in this form when we are ready to go. So that is why, if you want to practice this thing, you can't do too much. First of all, if you make up your mind, I have been fed up with this world, first qualification. I think my time here is over. I want to go to my true home, where I belong. You come to this conclusion, therefore you are a seeker of your true home. Now you are seeking something. What else should you do? Should you go around looking for a master? If you go around looking for a master, you will find only those who say we are masters. So you miss the real one. In the beginning you miss the real one. And the ones who you meet, they are working at a worldly level. They are saying, give us money, we'll give you such kinds. We'll give you the truth. They charge physical money for giving you, is it totally spiritual? How can they be masters? Perfect living masters will never charge you any physical compensation for the work they do for you. They come to give, not to take. And if they're takers doing business as masters, they can say anything they like, but they cannot be perfect living masters. It's not a business. Perfect living masters don't come to do business here for themselves or for anybody else. That is why you will be able to rule out many people if you just apply these. Then you want to know who is a perfect living master, and you search around, go all over the world, and you give up. I'm not sure. And then one person appears in your life, and suddenly you find that person who appears by coincidence, by circumstances, Not by your running around. You ran around enough. And he appears in your life by coincidence, by circumstances which you had never thought of. And you find he is the one who's pulling you with this unconditional love. You still don't know what his role is. And gradually you come to know and you begin to understand this is a relationship of two souls pulling each other and not a relationship of physical kind at all. As this feeling comes up, you discover he is your perfect living master. He did not say he was. He didn't need to say because his role was not that. What led to you to that perfect living master was not your running around, but your seeking. Therefore, the only task for a seeker to find the perfect living master is to seek within himself, not outside. If you seek within yourself, he will appear automatically in your life. I've seen this happening all over the world. There are people who seek and do nothing. The master appears. In India, we say, when a chela is ready, a guru appears. When a disciple is ready, a master appears. They don't say when a disciple is ready, he'll find a master. He appears. He appears in his life and he appears like ordinary person. Because it's not necessary to be extraordinary. If you're extraordinary, then you're part of this show here. Not part of a show internally or inside. So that is why the inner experiences are generated from an association with such a person. As you experience more and more of this unusual experience we are having of that kind of an unconditional love, we are affected by it. The mind fights, of course, because we are really on a particular awakening to go beyond the mind. So the mind which we have strengthened into an entity tries to fight us. It's almost like it's the creator. The mind, the universal mind, is the creator of time, space and creator of karma, creator of all these events here. Why will it let go of it? And the most of the enjoyment that is being done in this creation is with the senses and the mind. We are sometimes hiding behind the mind and not even enjoying so much. The mind has been given so much importance and so much life, it enjoys by itself. And we just watch helplessly sometimes. Sometimes we don't want it to do that, and we can't help it. It's such a strange situation we are in. So that is why the mind runs against this. When we are spiritual seekers, the mind becomes a negative force for us. It created time and space so that it can perpetuate this experience. And then becomes our own enemy. Something that was given to us to be useful to us becomes our own enemy and begins to work against us. And what does it use to beat us down? It uses the biggest instrument it has, the first creation, time and space. It beats us with time and space. It ties us down. Time translated into Hindi is called Kaal. People have heard the word Kaal, they never knew the meaning was time. Kaal is a negative power because it functions as time. We are trapped only in time. Karma is only in time. Everything that you call a trap is caused by time and space. Time and space have created all negativity around us. There would be no negativity except for these new creations of time and space in which all events have been placed and karma has been created. And karma is such a strange thing. It's not only merely effect, cause and effect, an effect of a cause, which we myself, we make a cause and we make an effect. Actually, we make both together and divide by time. Cause, effect are the same. We separate them and make one as a cause, one as the effect, and we create karma. Karma is that if you do something which you consider good, you'll be rewarded for it. If you do something bad, you'll be punished for it. Simple rule that we have by the system of karma, using the mind, created our own morality and divided experiences into good and bad. Then when our conscience, a part of the mind, used for creating morality, creating good and evil, separating the other experiences from this moral code, say this is good, conscience speaks inside, that's a good thing to do. We get rewarded. This is something bad, don't do it. We still do it. We get punished. Sometimes we don't even do anything. The mind says, do it. We don't do it. We still create karma. We are still punished. Intention in our own head is creating karma, and punishing is because it's part of time and space. Because it's a negative power working through time and space for us. So that is why karma is not so simple. Karma is the biggest trap. And that's the biggest negative thing that is happening, that we are trapped into. And all the time forgetting. This karma has been created by the mind for itself. And we are merely giving power, life to the mind to enjoy something, and we get trapped into it. That is why the getting out of karma is the most difficult thing. Nobody can get out of karma except by going above the mind. There have been very highly enlightened people. They have to come back. We hear the story of Lord Krishna in India, who is worshipped as the avatar of Vishnu, the god of sustenance. In the Hindu mythology, they give such importance to Lord Krishna. He is worshipped as God. With all that power they have given to him. You should hear the story of what he says to his childhood friend, Udo, when they were children. He said, Udo, karma cannot be understood easily. Karman ki gat nyari. He said in the translation, it's a very strange thing what karma is. We don't realize it. And then he points out to an ant crawling. And he says, look at this ant crawling here. Just an insect. At one time, this very ant has been Brahma, the creator of this universe. At one time, this ant was Indra, the lord of one of the heavens in the astral plane. And yet he's an ant today because of his karma. When he did very good karmas, they all added up to his becoming the creator. And when that term was over, it's a time. He was not Brahma forever. He was there for a time. When the time was over, he became, for his earlier bad actions, an insect. And for some very good actions, he did all that. He became Lord of the Heaven. Then he attempts to become an insect after that. There is no atonement in the law of karma. It's placed on time. That means you do something good now, then you do something bad. You are rewarded for the good, and after that punished for the bad. Then you do more good to atone for the bad. You get more reward, but you're still punished for the bad. This whole concept that we can atone for our bad actions is not known to the law of karma, nor to our experiences in this physical world. You can see people undergoing such big changes in their life, good and bad, because that's the basis of the law of karma. If supposing time was not the intervening factor which separates, the atonement could overcome. Atonement could cover the old time when we did bad, all it, atonement covered that and we remove it. Atonement is in the future, the next. This time is such a strange creation. And it's the greatest trap for us. You look at time only from a commonsensical point. What is time? Time is only which we can divide into what has already happened, what we call past, what is going to happen, what we call future, and what is happening now. N-O-W, now. The big now. People are saying, live in the now, live in the now. When somebody tells me, I'm going to live in the now, I say, where have you been living the previous days? I want to meet a single person anywhere in the world who's not living in the now. We can't live anywhere else except in the now. We have no choice. Where we are living is now. No matter where, we are always living in now and here. You can't change it. You can go anywhere, you're still in now and here. That is why when somebody says, live in the now, what lesson is he giving to us? We are in the now. Now has no time. So we are really living in no time. There must be some sense in this, that here we are free of time. Just because we happen to be in the now. And now has no time, not even a millionth part of a nanosecond. The moment a billionth part of a nanosecond passes, it's past. Before it came, it was future. Now is a timeless moment between the future and the past. There is no time whatsoever in now in which we live. And how are we experiencing time? There must be some good reason that we are all living in time. We are looking at watches, looking at calendars, and every day making arrangements for different hours of work. Where is this time coming from? If the only place we live day and night is now, then how does time come into play? Now is nothing but immediate past memory. What just happened a few seconds ago, I said now. I am talking to you in the now. Before I said these words, they were future. After I said they were past, I call it now. There's no real now in time. What we think is now is immediately short time in the past. That's it. The past is past. The now present is also past. It's recent past. And past a little more further away is past. Both are past. What about future? Is there a future? How is future created? Supposing we stop having any hope, we stop having any fear, we stop anticipating anything. Three things only. If these three verbs, hoping, fearing, and anticipating, disappear from all the dictionaries and from our lives, there will be no future. Have you ever thought of it? That future is created by our doing something, which is hoping, fearing, anticipating. You don't do these three things, future disappears. There is no future at all known to us. And when you hope, no matter how short the hope, it's in the past. It can't be in the now. Now has no time. When you fear, it's in the past. It's just recent memory. So the future is entirely in the past. Examine carefully that what we call time and what we think an experience of going through time is purely an experience of the past. And there is no way that anybody can experience the past except through memory. Therefore, memory is the real cause of all our experiences in time. If we had no memory, there'd be no past, present, and future. Memory is creating these experiences. And memory is not a physical thing. Memory is installed in our mind. Memory is installed in our causal self. Memory is what I described earlier in the morning, is when we put a lot of events on a timeline in the causal plane, they become our life here. That's when we pick up those DVDs. Memory is nothing but those DVDs which create this life. Now this may look just an intellectual discussion. It doesn't remain intellectual discussion if you go and see those things. See how it's being created. And you can see it. Withdrawal of your attention up to the point where you can be unaware of your physical body, unaware of your senses, will reveal this information and truth to you. And you'll find out that's exactly how life is being created, and yet it looks so real. Time looks so real. Imagine the power of illusion that a now that has no time whatsoever is looking like actual time. And the events are all created by memory. Therefore, if you install one memory capsule in the causal level, picking up one of those patterns, it creates a human life. But once it creates a human life, then it creates all previous lives. Because you can't have under the law of karma, under the law of these events, you cannot have a present life if you don't have a previous cause for this life. And the events of this life must relate to previous causes. So automatically, even if you come to this experience from your true home for one lifetime, and you do come only for one lifetime to start with, you're not interested in staying here forever. One lifetime is good enough, no matter what DVD you pick up. You come for one lifetime, and those notional lifetimes you have never lived become your past lifetime, because your events cannot be created except from those past lifetimes, which you never lived. Yet they are your memory, because the memory capsule captures all those infinite past lives. So you come here and live your life according to your past life, which you never lived. But then this life you actually experience. And in this life you create karma, causes, also picked up from the same memory, and die and come back to continue. Then it becomes real. Then past lives become real. Imagine we should have come from our true home. Look at the picture. We have come from a true home to have a different experience. Okay, we generated the tools necessary for a different experience. We generated the mind, generated sense perceptions, generated physical systems. Okay, and here we have physical bodies sitting here. We generated these tools so we can have experience of physical life and having a physical life. And then instead of saying, good, I have this nice experience now going back home, he said, no, I want more of this, more of this, more of this. I'm attached here. What are we creating? We didn't come for that. It's like somebody going to an amusement park, a carnival or something, and all the show, the rides there are very nice, and we go and we enjoy. After end of the day, we go back home. Supposing we say, no, we like this thing, we want to possess this, we want to buy the equipment there, we want to settle down there. We are trapped. This is what we have done. We came to a carnival. We came to an unusual experience of duality, an experience missing in our true home. We didn't come to create the same thing that we had. We came to have a variety of conscious experiences. There was no duality, no pairs of opposites, no time existing there. We said, let's have a different experience. And we came here for a different experience of time, space, events, karma, duality, opposites, and got trapped into it. Just because attachments. More desires, more attachment. They were interesting things. That's why we got attached. But we forgot why we came here. We totally forgot. And got so immersed. Thank God we made an arrangement before we came, how to go back if we get tired. And that is when a perfect living master appears in our life, when we are ready to go back. That's what is meant by readiness. When a chela is ready, when a disciple is ready, the guru appears, the master appears. You don't find him, he appears in your life when we are ready. Readiness is that state of the soul, the state of the soul, not of the mind. The state of the soul when it is defying even its own mind and understand the mind is standing in its way. When you have that feeling inside, you want to go home, but your mind and your thinking and your thoughts are trying to hold you back, you're ready. And that's the time when a perfect living master appears. But if you are seeking other things, different masters and teachers will appear and give you those experiences. I am only talking of the seekers of their true home beyond the mind. Because that is what is the ultimate aim if you go there. Somebody can put a simple question to me. This may be a bad life, it may be ups and downs and all that. At least we have company here. We have friends here. And you mean to say we should just walk inside and go to a true home, which you ultimately say is only one consciousness. Won't we be very lonely there? We are going from nice company here to a place of loneliness, and you call it a spiritual journey? You call it a spiritual enlightenment? Who wants this kind of enlightenment? The truth is completely opposite of that. The truth is all the company you have generated here is created from there. The truth is that totality contains everything, including what is here. We are not going away from this. We are going to that where everything is included. Short of that, only part of it is included. The true home is very different from any other level of consciousness. When we are here in the physical body, we can have an experience of another level. And we all have it, called the sleep state. We go to sleep and we dream. In the dream, we see things, we see people, we run around, we see a world. And the laws of that state is different than the laws of wakeful state. The laws there say you can think of Chicago one moment, New York next moment, you are in New York. It looks normal. Nobody in a dream has ever questioned, how come 1 second ago I was at one place, another second I'm somewhere another place? How did it happen? Nobody ever asked. Normal. It's normal in a dream state. We fall off and don't get hurt. It's normal. Sometimes we wonder why, but we're normal. And we can do so many things in dreams we can't do here. We can create things there which we can't create here. Rules are different, but look real. We're dreaming, we are here. And we have no idea what is happening to the body sleeping here. Our self is no longer in the body sleeping here. Our self is in the dream body, moving around in the dream. It's the same self. It's not a different self. It's not that your real self, wakeful self, was sleeping here and the dream self was there. There are no two selves. The same self that was in the wakeful state was the self in the dream state. In fact, there was an example I often give of a Chinese philosopher, Fahin. Fahin had a dream in which he dreamt that he was a butterfly. And he was flying around in a garden full of unusual flowers. The flowers were emitting radiance and light and such beautiful colors. He knew instantly that these flowers are not regular physical flowers, they are heavenly flowers, that he is in a higher state of consciousness, that he has reached somewhere like a heaven. And he flew with his wings all over the garden, enjoying itself. Then he woke up in a physical world. And he marveled to him, that looked much more real than the flowers here. Maybe that is the reality. And this is a dreamlike state. I mean, now, is it true? He asked himself, am I really a butterfly? Now dreaming that I am Fahin the philosopher? Or am I Fahin the philosopher who had a higher dream that he was a butterfly? He told his friends, philosophers, shared this experience with them. They said, Fahin, don't be stupid. You can't be a butterfly. You don't look like a butterfly. You don't fly like a butterfly. You are a human being. How can you say you are a butterfly? What happened was, in the dream, you saw a butterfly flying. You could not be a butterfly. He said, I never saw a butterfly fly. I was flying. I had wings. I was a butterfly. The self was exactly the same. Fahin had the same self as Fahin, same self as a butterfly. And if he went into higher self level, he'll still be the same self in Fahin, the same self in the astral body, same self in the causal body, same self in the soul, same self in totality of consciousness. The self never changes. Everything else changes, except the self. If you have discovered yourself, you have discovered the truth. If the truth is defined as something that never changes, the only thing I know of which never changes is the self, the experiencer of all things around it. Self never changes, experience changes. That is where the truth lies in the self. And if we can go to the self, we found the truth. We are enlightened. So that is why the self never changes, no matter what kind of experience you are having. Because the self is the experiencer at all times. So it's the same self, the experiencer. If there are different selves, our bodies are different at different levels. Our forms are different. Sometimes we are formless. Supposing we are completely formless, what will be there? Consciousness will still be there, and that will be the self. And will be the same self that is thinking as a human being today. Of course, this creates more problems for people sitting here. We who are sitting here, we have a problem. How many selves are there? If the totality of consciousness is only one, there should be only one self. How are we so many sitting here? In which one of these is the self sitting? If it's the only one and the only truthful one, we are so many sitting here, in which person is the self sitting? Is sitting in all of us. But it's still one. Now this is where the mind breaks down and cannot answer this question. How can one be in many? How can one be in many and remain one? How can one be in many and never split into many? Remain one and still be one, still be many in experience. It's not difficult to answer from our own experience. When we go to sleep, have a dream, and see 20 people in the dream. Some are known to us, some are strangers. We talk to them. And in our state of enlightenment, in the dream, we say, really, we are only one. And those people in the dream ask, who is the one? Which one? We 20 people are here. We are all separate. Who is the one? We are 20. You can't be one into 20 people. Then we discuss this in the dream. Then we wake up. Only one dreamer had the dream of 20 people. They were not 20 people. It was an experience of 20 people. The dreamer was only one. When you wake up, you discover where the one was, the one who woke up, not the one who you saw in the dream. Similarly, here we see so many. When you wake up to totality, they were all part of one dreamer. As it happened, the dreamer did not dream once, he dreamt several times. Dream within dream within dream. When it came to the sixth dream, we all appeared. And now who is dreaming there? Whoever is experiencing that I am the self and I am dreaming. Whoever is experiencing amongst us here, I am the self, I am watching this, I am listening, I am doing what is going on. Whoever is that is the self. As it happens, we all are having that experience. As yet, when we wake up, it will be one dreamer in which has created by all. So that is why this process of creating the many in the one starts from our true home itself. It doesn't need to come down to the physical level to create the many. The many were created in our true home, such kind as the many. That's why we have souls and totality which are the same. The same single consciousness is having the experience of the many within itself. In order to have experience of what it is being. Its being is love, its being is consciousness, its being is total knowledge. And to experience that, it becomes the many within itself. This reminds me, as a child, since I was born in a household following the system, for some time I rebelled against it, that I am being misled into something by my parents. They thinking I never got a chance to investigate what the truth is. So for some time I was investigating everything else. I didn't find many better answers. But anyway, during that time, I was told that this situation of our soul is that we belong to an ocean, a total ocean, two ocean of reality, God, whatever you call it. It's one big ocean. And we are all here, sitting here, drops of that ocean, separated far away from that ocean. For a long time, we have been so troubled by our mind, troubled by our circumstances, troubled by our karma here, and the drop of ocean is longing to go back to its source, the ocean. One day, with the help of a guru, of a master, we will fly back, and stage by stage, we'll go fly from one stage to another stage, then we fly higher stage, ultimately we'll go to the total ocean and merge in it. They said, this is the spiritual path. I thought to myself, I'm sharing my thought of that time. I thought to myself, as a drop of ocean, I have some identity. I have a personality of my own. And they are telling me, do all this, go through all this journey, go through all these levels, one after the other, we fly so high, and then go and merge in an ocean, I lose everything I have. What does the ocean gain? One more drop? Who cares? An ocean with trillions of drops is getting one more drop added on. Ocean is carefree, completely careless. It's a completely lose-lose game. The spiritual path is a lose-lose game if that is true. If we are individuated pieces of ocean, separated from the ocean, and we have to struggle hard to go back and merge in it, there's no winner at all. We lose what we have, and the ocean doesn't gain much. Doesn't gain nothing. I was very disappointed with this path, only at this thought of mine. But I was wrong. We are not the drop of ocean separated from the ocean. We are in the ocean. We never left it. We only are participating in the one great ocean, as a drop participating in that ocean. And our journey is to expand our awareness. When we expand our awareness to a bigger drop, we're still in the ocean. When we become a still bigger drop, we're still in the ocean. When we become the ocean, we're still the ocean. You're always the ocean. It's just an experience of individuation in the ocean. And all other experiences came from that. That made sense to me. This is not a journey to be separated and go and join somebody. It's a journey of your own revelation, of your own discovery, who you really are. So spiritual path is to discover who you really are. And when you discover, it includes everything that's ever been created. How can anything exist outside of totality? Otherwise, you can't call it totality. When we say totality of consciousness, It means total. It means what is happening here is part there. That everything that's ever happened in any level of consciousness is all there at one go, in a timeless moment. Therefore, when you reach your true home and you are there, you get everything, including what is here. You don't miss anything. You have the entire company, much bigger company than here. And yet you are also one. That's the most beautiful experience one can ever imagine. But the experience actually is much better than what you can imagine. Here, if you haven't gone to the true home, but you only go one level, then it's totally different. Then the story is different. Because then you are missing one part, going into another. It's like a dream. You have a dream, you are in the dream, but you don't have the experience of the wakeful state. You lost one awareness to get another. You wake up, the dream has gone, it's unreal. This becomes the reality. You go to the astral plane, that becomes the reality. Physical becomes really unreal. You go to causal plane, everything else becomes unreal except the causal plane. You go beyond the mind even to the first stage where you haven't joined with totality, even as a soul. You are still the soul, the spiritual unit with no mind, timeless. And yet you don't have the experience of totality. Only that soul is real, everything else is unreal. It's only when you go to the top that everything comes back. What is the significance of this statement? What is the significance of what I'm saying? Significance is that different teachers, enlightened people that we come across, they are enlightened up to a particular level of experience. People have gone to the astral plane, they are enlightened people. They have reached something which is beyond physical. People have gone to the causal plane are more enlightened people. They come back with some memories, some not, of those experiences. But for one time, they had only one experience. At all levels, you have only one reality at one time. Except in a true home where it's real and unreal at the same time. Everything is totally there. That is why a perfect living master who comes into our life from that level, he does not speak to us from any higher level. He speaks to us from total levels, including this one. Big difference. If you reach that level, you'll be the same. Perfect living master do not come to make us better people. They do not come to improve our lives. They do not come to change the world. They come to make those who are marked during their lifetime on this physical universe and the timeline in which they come in response to the seekers whom they come to pick up, who we call marked souls, marked for that particular person. They come to pick them up and take them back home. And therefore, they speak when they are here from their true home and from every level that's required. A big difference. They do not come from a past experience they are having. They come from something they are aware of at all times. Whether they are sitting here on astral plane, they are sitting at all planes at the same time. And they are doing work at all these planes with different souls. It's not only they come for a particular soul here. There are souls trapped in many areas beyond this. There's souls trapped in the astral plane. There's souls trapped in the causal plane. And they come for all of them. Whoever is marked and is ready to go home. Readiness comes when you desire your true home. Nothing short of that. If your desire is for something less, you'll find many masters who take you there. So I have shared these things with you mainly because you are seekers. If you are not seeking, I don't have to share anything with you. But since you are seekers of the same thing I am a seeker, we are co-travelers on the same journey, same path. And as a co-traveler, maybe a little more experienced in this physical time because of my age. I'm just claiming some credit for my age. Just because I turned 90 this year. Therefore, I'm claiming some experience ahead of you. And somebody comes here, I bow to those people who are over 80, over 90, just for the same principle. Just because of that, I'm sharing these experiences that we are travelers, that our minds create doubts, our mind creates skepticism, which is good. Very often it's very valid skepticism to avoid our being trapped by people who are not masters, but claim to be masters, to avoid, because everything can be copied by people for the sake of business, for the sake of money, for the sake of fame, for the sake of many reasons. And they can copy a perfect living master and say all those things and become like that. But they will get angry if you use a safety pin. They will be lustful if you give them temptation. And they will be possessive in order to get your wealth. They will have all the weaknesses we all have. Therefore, we can test them out very quickly. Yet they will say the same things. You cannot judge from what people say. Judge from how they act. Judge from what they do to your heart, to your soul. Judge what you feel inside. And don't be in a hurry. Ever. Take your time. We have been here a very long time. This physical body was a very short speck of time. We have been here over and over again. And we will stay over and over again. Even though we are ready. And that master, perfect living master, comes. Perfect. Because he is coming from above the mind. Everything below the mind is imperfect. Perfection is only above the mind. Perfection only takes place when you see totality. If you see parts, it's imperfect, no matter what. A beautiful picture of my master. When I look at it, I look at it in one glance. Beautiful. I can cut this picture into several pieces, 1-inch squares, and see it over and over again. I can see 1,000 times, I'll never see the master and never enjoy the picture. Seeing something total is very different from seeing partial. Mind sees only partial. Mind does not have the capacity to see the total. Mind is analytical. It breaks it to pieces even if it is total, in order to understand it, in order to see it. Therefore, it can never see the total. It's always imperfect. Soul is perfect. It does not go into divisions. It goes into seeing the total. My soul looks at this picture, I remember my master, I remember the whole thing in one go, in one instant. But the mind can start analyzing. No, that doesn't look like the right beard of his. His was more white beard, I think. I can start the questioning and analyzing and spend my whole life with analyzing. Some people do that. Some people want to analyze. Why they say skepticism is good, it's a point at which the analysis must stop. What are you analyzing for? What's the end? Are you analyzing for the sake of analyzing? Or is there an end to your analysis? Why are you analyzing? If there's a goal for analyzing, set a time limit. Say, I'm going to test out this thing. I'm going to examine this. Skepticism is good to avoid getting trapped by these people who are just playing a game with us. And yet, skepticism shouldn't go that far that even when we are having evidence, one after the other, we are still saying, I'm still skeptic. Evidence comes in the form, two forms. One, your own experience inside, whether it's in an alteration in your own outlook in life, whether it is in the external experience that you are having, or the internal experience that you are having, or the coincidental experiences you are having, where the inner gut feeling tells you the same thing which an outer sign shows you. There are many signs to show you that you are on the right track. So I can go at length into some talk with you about the various signs you can see if you are on the right track, either in identifying a perfect living master or on your own spiritual growth. But there are good signs even available to us here. But the best sign is if you are pulled by the unconditional love of a person who can talk to you not from his learning, not from books, directly from what he's experiencing as he talks to you. If you can find such a person who talks to you and the love grows unconditionally, follow that person. As simple as that. Therefore, I have shared these things to you as co-travelers. So if I have said something that you didn't like, you dismiss it. And what you like, you practice it. But don't leave it here. Take it with you. If you have found some useful tip in your own experience, in your own meditation, use it. So very often we hear some good tips, but we leave them where we hear them. They go in from one ear, and as we leave the hall, they go out from the other. So keep them with you and practice them, and I'll see you next month again. Thank you very much.